Hello, and welcome to this presentation, Measuring Filters with the FBC 1500. In this presentation, we'll show you how to make basic measurements of radio frequency filters using the vector network analyzer mode of a Rohde & Schwarz FBC 1500 spectrum analyzer. This presentation covers the essential information needed to make basic filter measurements with the FBC. But if you're interested in learning more about tracking generators, Vissoir bridges, or filter measurements, please see the separate presentations on each of these topics. Let's start with a brief review of filters. Filters are two-port devices that attenuate radio frequency signals as a function of their frequency. Another, somewhat simplified way of saying this is that filters pass some frequencies and block other frequencies. Filters are generally grouped into four categories based on the frequency ranges that they attenuate. Low-pass filters pass lower frequency signals and block higher frequency signals. And high-pass filters do the opposite. They pass higher frequencies and block lower frequencies. A bandpass filter passes only signals within a certain frequency range or band. And a notch or band stop filter is used to block a usually narrow frequency range. Filters are critical components in almost all radio frequency applications, and may be either board-level components or external connectorized devices. There are many different instruments and techniques that can be used to design, adjust, and measure filters, and in this presentation, we'll show how this is done using the FBC 1500. The Rohde & Schwarz FBC 1500 spectrum analyzer contains both an integrated tracking generator and an internal Vissoir bridge. The tracking generator is an RF signal source whose frequency can follow or track the measurement sweep. This signal is used both as the input to the filter, as well as the reference for the measurement results. The integrated Vissoir bridge enables the FBC to make reflection measurements on filters as well. We'll discuss this later in the presentation. Both scalar or magnitude measurements and vector or phase measurements can be made with the FBC. Measurement results can be also displayed in a variety of formats. In the remainder of this presentation, we'll go step by step through how to perform various filter measurements using the FBC. There are five basic steps in making filter transmission measurements: configuring the source or tracking generator, configuring the measurement frequency range, performing normalization, adjusting the trace type and/or resolution bandwidth, and viewing or analyzing the results. Let's start with configuring the source. To configure the FBC's tracking generator, press the measure hard key and then source. For filter measurements, we want tracking generator mode, in which the output of the generator is a CW signal whose frequency is coupled to the measurement frequency. That is, the source output frequency sweeps at the same rate as the measurement frequency. The output power of the generator is also configurable in units of dBm using the level key, with maximum output power level being 0 dBm. To avoid distortion and/or damage, it's important to ensure that the output level is not too high for the device under test. This is not a common concern when measuring passive or unpowered filters, but it can be an issue with active filters, which contain amplifiers or other active components. We also need to specify the frequency range over which the filter will be tested. This should be wide enough to include both the filter passband and some portion of the stop band. To define the frequency range, press the frequency hard key and enter the start and stop frequencies. The span key can also be used to enter these as center and span instead. The number of measurement or trace points over the span can also be specified by pressing the sweep hard key and adjusting the number of points. A greater number of points will provide greater detail, but increases measurement time. Filter measurements on the FBC 1500 are made in vector network analyzer mode. To enter this mode, press the mode hard key on the front of the FBC and then choose vector network analyzer. Next, press the measure hard key and choose Transmission S21 for filter transmission measurements. We'll discuss reflection measurements later in this presentation. A very important part of any transmission measurement is normalization, and this should be performed before making any filter measurements. Normalization can remove or reduce the effects of cables and connectors on the measurements. To run normalization, press the Measure Hard key, select Calibrate, and then Normalize S2-1. A through should be connected between the cables that will be attached to the filter. After pressing Continue, normalization will complete in a few seconds. For the best accuracy, normalization should be rerun if the frequency range or number of trace points has been changed. Here is a typical display before normalization. Although the tracking generator output is constant, the frequency response and attenuation of the cables will create an uneven or wavy trace. After normalization has been run, the line should be flat, and the level of this line should be normalized to 0 dB. All filter transmission measurements will now be relative to this level. Note that the calibration status is shown on the upper left portion of the screen. Uncal means uncalibrated, and norm indicates that normalization has been performed for the configured frequency range. After normalization, transmission measurements can be made. The through that was used for normalization is removed and replaced by the filter under test. By default, the FPC will sweep and update measurement results continuously, but this can be changed to a single sweep by pressing the sweep hard key. The vertical scaling can be adjusted using the amplitude hard key. Reference level is used to define the upper limit of a trace, and range reference position is used to scale the trace vertically and to move the trace up or down. Note that the FPC also has an auto range key that can adjust these values automatically. Here is an example of a bandpass filter measurement. In the next few slides, we'll go through how to adjust additional parameters and how to analyze or measure the properties of a filter from a trace. There are two settings which can help when viewing measurement results. The first is changing the trace mode from Clear Write, which updates the display with every sweep, to Average, which displays the user-defined average of n traces. Averaging can help reduce noise on the trace, and this is particularly true when looking at the stop band. The averaged trace on the right has much lower noise in the stop band compared to the unaveraged trace on the left. Another important setting is resolution bandwidth, which can be manually adjusted by pressing the bandwidth hard key and then RBW manual. Lowering the resolution bandwidth will decrease the displayed average noise level, or DANL, but will also increase measurement time. For example, measuring with a 100 kHz resolution bandwidth gives a DANL of about minus 80 dBm, but decreasing it to 1 kHz lowers the DANL to about minus 100 dBm. One reason why trace averaging and lowering DANL are important is they allow more precise measurements of the difference between passband and stopband attenuation. This is something we'll talk about in more detail in just a few moments. Filter characteristics are determined using markers, which are enabled using the marker hard key. Up to 6 markers can be placed on a trace, and these can be either absolute markers or delta markers, which show the difference between marker values. This can be toggled by using the marker type key. Another marker hard key is used to automatically place markers on the peak or minimum values of the displayed trace. Let's use markers to make some basic filter measurements. We've placed 3 markers, one on the center frequency of our passband filter, here approximately 454 MHz, and one each on the lower and upper 3 dB points, which is how filter passband is normally specified. Looking at the difference between these two 3 dB points, we can calculate the passband of our filter as being approximately 34 MHz. Next, we'll use a standard marker and a delta marker to measure insertion loss and out-of-band rejection. Insertion loss is how much the filter attenuates signals in the passband. This should be as small as possible, and here our filter has an insertion loss of about 1.6 dB. On the other hand, a high out-of-band rejection is generally desirable, since this is a measure of how much the filter attenuates signals outside of its passband. Measured with a delta marker relative to the passband, the out-of-band rejection for this filter is approximately minus 78 dB. Recall that using averaging and a lower resolution bandwidth can help in making accurate measurements of the difference in levels between the passband and the stopband. The last basic measurement we'll look at is passband ripple, or how much amplitude variation there is in the passband. Here, we're looking at a low-pass filter with a 3 dB cutoff frequency of about 428 MHz. The highest gain within this passband is minus 0.2 dB at about 30 MHz, and the lowest gain is about minus 1.5 dB at about 359 MHz. Using a delta marker between these points, we can directly read off the passband ripple, which for this filter is approximately 1.3 dB. Next, we'll look at making reflection measurements on filters. Most filters are reflective in that they block or attenuate signals by reflecting power outside of the passband back toward the source. In cases where reflected power might be an issue, special absorptive filters can be used instead. Although we normally associate filter testing with transmission or S21 measurements, reflection or S11 measurements are often useful because they show how well a filter is matched at different frequencies, as well as whether the filter is reflective or absorptive. We make reflection measurements using the FBC by connecting the generator output to one port of the filter and terminating the other port. Note that this is a so-called vector measurement, that is, we're measuring both magnitude and phase, and therefore this measurement uses the FBC's internal Vizoire bridge. The most common ways of looking at filter reflection measurements are using a return loss plot, as well as a Smith chart. Both of these can be used to visualize impedance matching, both within and outside of the filter passband. But note that the FBC also supports a number of other display formats as well. The steps in making a reflection measurement are essentially the same as for transmission measurements, with one exception. Instead of performing a normalization using a through, in reflection measurements, we need to perform a one-port calibration using a set of calibration standards. Let's look at this in a bit more detail. A one-port calibration should be performed before any reflection measurement, and this process involves sequentially attaching an open, a short, and a match to the tracking generator or RF output port. These standards can be in the form of discrete standards or may be combined into a calibration T. In addition to these manually attached standards, electronic calibration units can also be used. These switch the standards in and out automatically and are controlled by the FBC. Regardless of which type of standards are used, the process is started by pressing the measure hard key and then calibrate, one port selective span, and selecting the calibration kit. Next, simply follow the prompts for connecting the manual standards or the automatic calibration unit to the RF output port. Let's look at some filter reflection measurement results. Here we're looking at a bandpass filter which has a high return loss within the filter passband, meaning that power outside of this band is returned to the source. Looking at the Smith chart display, we can see a high degree of impedance mismatch outside of the passband. The trace lies near the edge of the Smith chart for the stopband frequencies. Both of these plots are consistent with a reflective filter that attenuates signals by returning power outside of the passband back towards the source. Let's end with a brief summary. Vector network analyzer mode on the Rohde & Schwarz FPC 1500 spectrum analyzer can be used to measure filter characteristics, including both transmission or S21 measurements, as well as reflection or S11 measurements. These are made by using the analyzer's internal tracking generator and Vizoire bridge, so no additional external devices are needed to make filter measurements. However, it's important to perform a normalization or a calibration before making measurements, and these require either manually attached calibration standards or an automatic calibration unit. Measurement parameters and display modes are user-adjustable, and filter characteristics such as frequency, bandwidth, attenuation, and ripple can all be easily measured using markers. And although this presentation has been focused on filter measurements, the methods and settings used for measuring filters can often also be applied to other two-port devices, such as couplers, amplifiers, etc. This concludes our presentation, Measuring Filters with the FPC 1500. If you'd like to learn more about network measurements, filters, or spectrum and network analyzers from Rohde and Schwartz, please see the links in the video description. Thanks for watching.